Hello everyone, here is Emad Magdy speaking to you. I am a lecturer of nephrology at the Internal Medicine Department, Mansoura University. Today our lecture will be on the history taking from a renal case. I used to make the references at the last slide, but here it's very important to mention the references in the first slide. Why? Because we have to know that there is some trusted sources to read for the clinical examination and the clinical ways to examine the patient, take the history, make the general examination and local examination. I prefer the Hutchinson. There is also the McLeod. All these are trusted books to take the clinical knowledge from. Before telling you the items of the history taking, what should I take, what should I speak to patient, we should know the philosophy of history taking. The idea of history taking, that me as a physician will meet the patient in the outpatient clinic or the emergency room or the ward, and then live with him for days, examining him, know about his past medical history, know more about the current situation, what the patient suffer from, and then I have to summarize these days I stayed with the patient in minutes. So I should speak in professional language when I paraphrase the patient history or introducing the patient history to other colleague or to consultant or consultant everywhere in the world to take consultation on the case. So we should all speak a unified language. We should all respect the professionalism of how can we introduce our patients to the audience. To take good history, you should have your way to your patient, because your patient may be asked for those questions multiple times a day from the resident doctor and then from the specialist, from the consultant, from the nurse, from the students who are in training. So you should find your way to the patient. As it's simple, but we sometimes forget this. Number one, we should gain the familiarity with the patient and consider the personality and the cultural level. So the experience of the history taker is to speak the patient's own language and the own cultural level, respect all the challenges the patient have, respect the suffering of the patient, respect the symptom of the patient, whatever it is significant to you or not. Number three, consider the emotional state. Then we'll jump to the first step or first phase of history taking, is to know what are the items I should ask the patient about. Okay, this is phase one. Phase two is to know what are the spectrum of symptomatology the patient may come complaining from. And this can be applied to all branches in medicine. So prepare yourself before visiting any department to know the symptomatology of this department or the symptomatology of this chapter before visiting the department. And then after visiting the department, try to practice this knowledge. How can we do this? I will apply in this presentation, but this is our target. So we have fixed points in any history, in any department. You should ask the patient about the personal history, chief complaint, present history, past history, and family history. Regarding the personal history, we will take those items: the name, the age, the gender, occupation, residence, marital status, special habits. All these are very important. Why? Because all of them can be signified in some disease. So the age group of the patient, so patients with old age differ from middle age, differ from young age, and all of them, each category of those have some diseases which is prevalent in this age and rare in the other age. This is number one, and this can be applied to the gender. The occupation, in any chapter of medicine, you will find a special category of occupational diseases related to some occupations, occupational diseases of the kidney, occupational diseases of the lung. We should know in each chapter what occupations may present with problems. The residents can give you an impression about the socioeconomic state. Again, we have some disease which is prevalent in the rural areas, others of the urban areas. So between rural and urban, civilized, non-civilized, low socioeconomic, high socioeconomic, the marital status and parity is also important, than special habits. Special habits, we should ask about the presence or absence, and if presence, we should know the magnitude. So special, we have, if the patient is a smoker, we should know or calculate the smoking index. If the patient is alcoholic, we should know how much he drink per day. If he's on other types of smoking, if he is an addict to chemical material or pharmaceutical material, all these are points to ask in the special habit. Complain. Complain is the head of your history. So you should be very careful when applying the main complaint of the patient. So if you try to speak to the patient, he or she will tell you multiple complaints, I'm complaining of blah, 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 blah. But the wise doctor should choose the most important or the one which forces a patient to come to this visit, to the outpatient clinic or to the ward, hospital. We should, as I mentioned before, we should respect all the patient complaints, but we should pick up and analyze the most important ones. Okay? We will analyze all the complaints, but we should choose the head of the topic. We should choose the most important symptom the patient complaining from. We have two challenges in the complaint, or maybe three challenges. Challenge number one is to define the complaint. The complaint rule should be in the patient own word, not a medical term. But what is the meaning of the patient own word? The patient own word mean that it's not a medical term. Okay? So no edema, but a swelling of the lower limbs. No tachycardia, but palpitation. All these are linguistic expressions, not medical expressions. So this is in patient own word. But should be of the group of symptoms I study before coming to the department. Should all the systems have certain group of clinical presentations which may the patient may come complaining from, and in each one there have some questions in the analysis and the good analysis of this complaint. So my patient should complain from one of those complaints, and subsequently I will ask him or her the questions under the analysis of this complaint. So in patient own words, no scientific term, and should mention the duration of complaints. This is a challenge number one. Challenge number two, the accuracy of the data, the accuracy of the complaint. We have two difficult points of the in the accuracy of the complaint. Number one, we have words and phrases that need clarification. Because we are in the academic studying, no certain definition of diarrhea and constipation, of dizziness and headache, and they will have criteria for diagnosis. So the patient of diarrhea should fulfill the criteria of 1, 2, 3. the patient with constipation criteria of 1, 2, 3, but the patient may complain of those complaints without fulfillment of those criteria. Okay? Yeah, so number one, I should confirm on him the criteria of diagnosis of these words or phrase. And we have medical terms that may be used by the patient imprecisely. Like, I have arthritis. Arthritis in the medicine means inflammation of the joints that inhibit the patient from movement or inhibit this joint from movement. The patient will tell you that he or she have arthritis if he or she only have a pain in the joint. Sciatica, migraine, fits, stroke, angina, heart attack, pleurisy, cystitis. The patient, those are common words in the public language, and you can hear this from the patient, but you should translate this to one of the symptomatology and don't tell tell us in the history that the patient complain of arthritis, because arthritis is a term should be confirmed by examination. So it cannot be confirmed by just only taking history. The last challenge in the complaint is to weigh the complaint. The complaint is a subjective data. What's the meaning of subjective? We all have a different thresholds for sensing the complaints. So what is considered severe for you may be mild or moderate to me. And our mission in history taking, one of our missions is to weigh the complaint, weigh the severity of complaint. We have measures that can transfer the subjective data to objective data. So the exercise tolerance, the eating habits, the social life. So I try to compare the patient normal life with the current or present complaint. I will ask him or her, did this complaint prevent you from doing your daily work, prevent you from go to sports, prevent you from eating well? This may tell me the severity of the complaint. We should know how to weigh each complaint while studying the complaint. So if I ask about the pain, I should know what are the criteria of severe pain. Severe pain is also associated with vagal stimulation, and this vagal stimulation causes tachycardia, sweating, vomiting. If I hear from the patient that the complaint is associated, I have a pain and this pain is associated with such symptoms, so it means that this pain is severe. Okay? And I should tell the audience this in the present history to be able to know how severe the condition is. So this is the personal history. The present history. The present history have certain items which should be fulfilled. Number one, analysis of the main complaint. And again, from where I can take this analysis? Again, from my study, from my expectation of the questions which should be fulfilled in the analysis of the main complaint. And that's why I asked you to choose the most important complaint. Because if you choose more than one and confuse yourself, this point and this first start of the analysis of complaint in the present history will be very difficult and confusing and will get you in stress, and you will not continue the history in a sane and confident manner. So try to do your best to concise the complaint, because this complaint will be the start of the present history. We should know all the analysis of each complaint and be prepared and ask the patient about. Then I will ask about any other associated complaint. If present, I should also analyze the other associated complaint. Other symptoms related to the same system. So if I have a complaint from the urinary system, I should check other symptoms related to the urinary system. And then spread to symptoms of other systems, because in the renal patient, as an example, the kidney can be affected in many systemic diseases and can be presented with a systemic manifestation multiple times. So I have to check if there is any symptom related to other system. History of diabetes and hypertension. Again, it is not acceptable to forget this in the present history. So the present history, diabetes, hypertension, any previous investigation or any previous therapies the patient know, because it's not expected that all patients know what type of investigations they have done or therapies they have taken. If it's present, okay. This section is the main core of the lecture. What are the renal perspectives, or this, what I mentioned to you, the previous slides are the general idea or the general principle of history taking. So taking, I told you that the main problem is to know the symptomatology of the system and then analyze the symptomatology well. I will tell you now what are the symptomatology related to renal patient and how can we analyze it. What are the spectrum of symptomatology I may find in the renal or urological disease? Number one, the first category, asymptomatic. Yes, in patient with renal disorders, symptoms and signs may be non-specific, even absent till the disease is severe. And the patient may be discovered accidentally when doing urine analysis for any purpose, for admission to faculty or getting a job, found asymptomatic urinary abnormality, like asymptomatic RBCs in urine, asymptomatic proteinuria, or accidentally discovered diminished kidney function when just to check the kidney function as a routine workup or before radiological assessment or contrast injection, the radiologist will ask for renal functions, so we should get an eye on the renal functions. When common presentation that the patient come to us with a chronic kidney problem but asymptomatic at all, and all of a sudden there is an overt renal failure that have been presented to you in the ER or in the outpatient clinic. In this situation, you should ask about a trigger factor which induce acute kidney problem on top of the chronic kidney problem. Those are the most common triggers that can cause this: the non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drug, the radiocontrast injections, the infections, ACE inhibitors, dehydration, and the anemia. Why? Non-steroidal can harm the kidney acutely and chronically. It can cause diminution of the renal perfusion by vasoconstriction of the afferent arteriole. It can cause acute idiosyncratic tubulointerstitial nephritis. The radiocontrast material can be precipitated in the tubules and make an obstruction. Infections can cause tubular interstitial nephritis. ACE inhibitors and angiotensin receptor blockers can cause efferent arteriolar vasodilatation, and this will decrease the intraglomerular pressure and decrease the GFR, especially if combined with non-steroidal, which vasoconstrict the afferent arteriole, or especially in cases of dehydration. When the patient is dehydrated, the decrease in the intraglomerular pressure can cause severe diminution of GFR. Many patients are asymptomatic and have a family history. Sometimes hematuria or proteinuria has been detected during a routine insurance medical examination or during pregnancy. So number the category number one is the asymptomatic, but or acute on top of chronic, and I should know the trigger and should know the common triggers. So it is not accepted to have a patient with a sudden or first discovered renal impairment and you don't ask him about those causes, because those are a very common triggers of renal impairment on top of chronic one or from the start acute kidney impairment. The other, the second group is the renal symptomatology. Those are the rest of the groups. We have a group of symptoms related to voiding, the action of voiding of urine. We have a group of symptomatology related to abnormalities in urine volume and decomposition. We have the pain, the swelling, the uremic and the systemic manifestations, and the specific renal syndromes. We will take each in short. Those voiding symptoms and pain may be more discussed in detail in the lecture of the urological history or the items of the urology, because the lower urinary tract symptoms are mostly related to urological disease. Okay, but we will take a small hint about it also. So what are the voiding symptoms? The voiding symptoms related to the act of micturition. During the storage phase of micturition, or during the voiding phase of micturition, or disturbance in the process at all, which can cause incontinence. The difficult part in this disease group of symptomatology, that is the confusing definition of each one of them, and the confusing question when you ask the patient about. So you should be prepared. What is the meaning of frequency? Frequency means increased micturation time, or the increased the number of times that the patient need to micturate. It is not related to the amount at all. Urgency is a sudden strong need to pass urine, and again it is not related to the action of urine itself. So urgency means that I have an extreme need to go to the toilet, but it's not related. I missed some drops or not, or have a large amount or small amount. It's not related. Those are related to the overactivity of the urinary bladder muscle and abnormal stretch receptor that make the brain feel many times that the bladder is full whenever it's not full. Nocturia, from its name, being wakened once or twice to void. Storage symptoms associated with bladder, prostate, or urethra problems, like the lower urinary tract infections, tumor, or urinary tract obstruction, or neurological complication. Voiding these symptoms are symptoms related to the act of micturition itself. We have the hesitancy. Hesitancy means difficulty in initiating the flow. Difficulty in initiating the flow. And they have separate causes in males differ from in females. We have the dribbling and the incomplete emptying. We have the dysuria, painful micturation. And at last, we have the incontinence, and the incontinence means involuntary release of urine, may be associated with urge sensation, so it's an urge incontinence, may be associated with increase in the intra-abdominal pressure, like cough or anything that can increase the intra-abdominal pressure, or may be mixed. The causes of urinary incontinence will be discussed thoroughly in the urology. So those group of symptoms may be collected in the benign bursitic hyperplasia. The patient may typically come complaining from a slow flow, hesitancy, incomplete emptying, dribbling after micturation, frequency and nocturia, palpable bladder. We will take, again, as I mentioned, those group of symptoms we will take in detail in these lectures and the urology history lecture. The third group are abnormalities in urine volume and composition. So I have now asymptomatic, then the lower urinary tract symptoms related to voiding or related to storage or incontinence. Then the third group is abnormalities in urine volume and composition. It may be abnormality in the amount, polyuria, oliguria, anuria, retention. I should be very accurate when defining my patient. Oliguria is a reduction in urine less than 400 ml per day. Anuria, reduction in urine less than 100 or 200 ml per day. Retention is a urinary tract obstruction. So what is the difference between oliguria, anuria, and retention? Oliguria, anuria is a medical problem, is a renal problem. There is no filtration of urine. But retention is a surgical problem. The urine is already made, but didn't find its way to outside due to obstruction at any level in the urinary tract. Abnormalities in composition or in color, like hematuria. Hematuria is a very important symptom, and take its importance from the multiple pathologies which can cause the urine to be red in color. And when I put in the complaint, I will not mention hematuria, because I will say that the patient complain of red urine, because this red urine can be just a color, can be RBCs, can be other content that make the urine red. So it is not only RBCs. I may have lists for differential diagnosis of hematuria, but the preferred one is this one. Why? Because this will help me to know or differentiate between the categories of causes of hematuria. So if I have the patient with red colored urine and I do urine analysis to him and don't found hemoglobin or RBCs, I will search for the causes of red urine, like those. It is a pseudo hematuria. If I found the urine analysis telling me that the patient has RBCs but no hemoglobin, I will pass to check the RBCs morphology. Is this RBCs dysmorphic, fragmented RBCs? If it's fragmented, it means that these RBCs come from the upper urinary tract and get fragmented in the tubules. So it is of glomerular origin. But if these RBCs are intact, it means that they are from the lower urinary tract, not passing to be fragmented in the tubules. If I don't find RBCs but find hemoglobin, it may be myoglobinuria or hemoglobinuria or rhabdomyolysis. So these are the how I categorize the red urine. I should know this. Okay? So this is the pseudohematuria. This is pseudohematuria with dipstick positive. The pseudohematuria with dipstick negative. And this glomerular disorders causing hematuria. And if it is intact RBCs, all other renal and urological causes, all these are present here. But my mission is to give you this scheme to differentiate between the broad categories of the cause. One of the other important or very important symptomatology is the proteinuria. And the patient will come complaining from frothy urine, will come complaining from swelling of his lower limbs, because according to the proteinuria and the degree or severity of proteinuria, the patient will be presented. If it is mild, it is just frothy urine. If it is severe and the patient lose much of his protein in urine, this will lead to decrease the oncotic pressure of the intravascular space, and the water will escape from the intravascular space to the interstitium, making the patient edematous and complaining of swelling of the lower limbs. Again, the proteinuria, we have wide spectrum of causes of proteinuria, but we should differentiate two types: the non-nephrotic proteinuria from nephrotic proteinuria. Because the nephrotic proteinuria more than 3.5 grams per day, is conclusive to the glomerular disorders. But proteinuria less than this amount can be glomerular or non-glomerular. The change on the color of the urine, this with hematuria of the fragmented RBCs, it will be smoky urine or Coca-Cola colored urine. When the patient have jaundice, the conjugated bilirubin and the concentrated urine, orange brown, the color of urine, and this is a color chart. I should ask the patient, which color of this is your urine? The color can be indicative about the hydration state. If the urine is concentrated, it will be dark. And those are the causes of red brown urine. So the number one, asymptomatic; number two, urological; number three, it changes in the compositions of urine; number four, the pain. What can cause pain in renal disease? The kidney tissue itself is not sensitive to pain and ischemia like the heart. But the capsule of the kidney is sensitive to tension. The ureter is a smooth muscle. When it's obstructed by stone, it will contract over the stone. It will give a renal colic. If I have infection around the renal capsule, and this renal capsule is inflamed, it will give pain. So we have a loin pain due to stretching the renal capsule or renal pelvis, will cause include infection, inflammation, and obstruction, and may be a chronic stretch of the capsule. Chronic dull aching, loin pain may occur with chronic renal failure or scarring from polycystic kidney. Constant loin pain with systemic manifestation, fever, rigors, and pain on voiding suggests infection, like acute pyelonephritis. So the pain may be dull aching, may be throbbing, may be maybe associated with systemic manifestations, may be chronic, And this is the famous renal colic, which is due to obstruction of the ureter and contraction of the ureter over a stone. This have a specific refer the pain referred to the back and to the medial aspect of the thigh or the testicles in males. This is the typical form of renal colic. By the way, it's a very severe pain and usually associated with the vagal stimulation symptoms I discussed at the first slides. Come to this fifth category and sixth category, which is a very, very important category. The specific renal syndromes. What is the meaning of specific renal syndrome? Specific renal syndrome means that when I collect those clinical presentations in a patient, it means 100% that the kidney is a primary organ of affection. I will notice the difference when I tell you the next categories as general, but here what the meaning of specific renal syndromes. We have clinical presentations of the glomerular disorders. I already discussed it in detail in the lecture of nephritic syndrome, but the most two important presentations of glomerular disease are that this glomerulus have a problem in its structure, have a problem in the filtration barrier, have a problem in the filtration space, have a problem in the urinary space. So it start to escape some important contents from the blood to the urine, namely the protein and blood. And if there is an inflammation and the infiltration of the kidney tissue or glomerular capillaries with white blood cells or inflammatory cells, which can do necrosis to the glomerular capillary, those also white blood cells will escape to the urine. So according to the spectrum, we have multiple spectrums. We have only just asymptomatic proteinuria, asymptomatic hematuria, gross hematuria, microscopic hematuria, and the two big syndromes, the nephrotic syndrome and the nephritic syndrome. And again, it is very well discussed in the lecture of nephritic syndrome. What are the items? And we have some severe form of nephritic syndrome, which is the rapid progressive glomerular nephritis. It comprises rapid deterioration of kidney function through a very short period, days to weeks. And we have the chronic glomerulonephritis, a chronic state of hypertension, mild renal impairment, and proteinuria and shrunken kidneys. Those are the differences between nephrotic and nephritic syndrome. Those are very important in the studying of glomerular nephritis. In the representation itself, the differential diagnosis, how can we analyze? You have a separate lecture for each one of them. And this is a small representation, how can we think in nephritic syndrome and think in nephrotic syndrome. How can we do the differential diagnosis according to these differential diagnoses? Other group of specific renal syndromes are the renal tubular syndromes. Most of patients with parenchymal renal disease or obstructive renal damage manifest with disordered tubular function. What is the main function of the renal tubules? Is to maintain or reabsorb the filtered water and electrolytes. So if I have a problem in the renal tubules, the disturbance in the water content of the body, either by increase or decrease, disturbance of electrolytes, electrolyte wasting like calcium, sodium, potassium, magnesium, all these will manifest systemically on the patient and cause acid-base disturbance, electrolyte disturbance, and fluid disturbances, fluid balance disturbances. The last group of symptoms is the general and systemic manifestations. And this group is in the opposition of the previous one. The specific renal symptomatology, as I mentioned, mean that the primary organ of affection is the kidney. Those group of symptoms means that when I found this symptom in the patient, it will not come to my mind for the first while that the kidney is affected. But the collection of those symptoms can be indicative of renal disease. And those group in the kidney patient are related to the patients with chronic renal impairment. We all know that the action of the kidney is to excrete the uremic toxins, have also some hormonal action in the form of erythropoietin release, which is very important in the erythropoiesis, and the vitamin D activation, which is very important, calcium phosphorus mineralization process, and have a very important action in acid-base regulation and the preservation of bicarbonate. So if I lose these functions gradually, the patient will suffer gradually from accumulation of uremic toxins, and those uremic toxins have an inflammatory effect on most of the mucosa and on the blood-brain barrier. So the patient will suffer from uremic encephalopathy or uremic affection of the mood, unstable behavior, disordered sleep, to the neuropathy, constipation, autonomic neuropathy, uremic encephalopathy at the end, all the manifestations of severe metabolic acidosis like the Cosmol breathing, rapid deep breathing, loss of endocrinal function may give the symptomatology of anemia, pallor, low cardiac output signs, all manifestations of impaired mineralization, bone aches, all those spectrum of symptoms are related to loss of one of those three functions. And if you see this symptomatology, at first, if I told you that the patient come complaining of persistent vomiting, the first thing you would search for or think for will be related to the GIT, not the kidney. But if you know that the very considerable part of our patients just first discovered with renal problem after vomiting, persistent vomiting, not responding to the usual anti-emetics or anti-acid treatment. So those are the common situations. The patient with renal impairment. I can have a patient with voiding symptoms, asymptomatic, pain, swelling, specific renal syndromes, special general renal symptomatology, and those special situations are specific questions in the history, which is very important in some category of the patients. In the hemodialysis patients, I should know how long the patient has been on dialysis, the vascular axis of the patient, because the vascular axis of the patient is related to many complications that the patient may suffer from. If the patient is dialyzing from central venous gas, it can be complicated by stenosis of this vein or infections. If the patient is dialyzing from arteriovenous fistula, I should know the site from how long this arteriovenous fistula is good or not. This is very important. The duration of dialysis, the rate of the fluid removal on dialysis, the parameters of dialysis adequacy. I should be confirmed that this patient take an adequate dialysis that can help him to maintain his life in a good quality of life. The dialysis prescription itself is very important, as I mentioned. The dry weight, the frequency of dialysis. The dry weight means the weight when the patient is not edematous, not hypertensive, and not also hypotensive or dehydrated. Dialysis access. Ask the patient about any symptom that occur on or after dialysis, because we have multiple complications which may be presented in the patient on the hemodialysis, like the hypotension episodes after the dialysis, the arrhythmia episodes, some idiosyncratic or hypersensitivity reactions on the session. At this mean that the patient is not stable enough, and I should introduce to adjust his session, adjust his parameters and dry weight. This for the dialysis patient. So we take now the personal history, the present history, the special renal symptomatology, and pass now to a very important items in any renal sheet or in any sheet in medicine, the drug history and the past history. There is no complete renal sheet without drug history, because the drugs in kidney, the drugs can affect the kidney in multiple ways. It can affect the kidney vasculature. It can affect the kidney interstitium. It can affect the kidney glomeruli. And we have, as I mentioned, in the non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs can cause all these. Can affect the efferent arteriole, the interstitium, the tubules, the glomeruli. So we should know all the drug history of the patient, for how long he or she take the drug, how much in each time. Do the patient use any herbal or complementary medicines or not? Because we have now a wide spectrum of disease which is related to the herbs, and they can cause acute interstitial nephritis. The past history is also very important. The past history of similar condition, especially in the patient with autoimmune disease, because their way of waxing and waning, natural history of the disease came up and slowed down, came up and slowed down. The drug intake, the infections, specific infections related to the kidney, like the streptococcal infections, like the TB, like the rheumatic fever, any previous history of blood transfusion, traveling abroad, all these are important items in the past history. The last thing is the family history. We have multiple diseases which run in families and congenitally acquired in the kidney, like the famous known autosomal dominant polycystic kidney disease. We should know the degree of consanguinity between the father and the mother of the patient. If there is any disease run in families, it does not only benefit my patient, but if I discover that the patient have such autosomal dominant disease, I should screen all his first degree relatives for having the same disease, because this may benefit them a lot to potentiate the screening programs and preventing the complications and to do the medical counseling and to prevent the patient from having any problem in the future. That's it. Those are the main items I should know in the history. I give you now one example of cases, and how can we ask on this, on the exams, what are the items we would like to know or show in the OSCE exam. This one is a 50-year-old patient developed a sudden reduction of urine volume after 3-day history of vomiting and diarrhea. And this sit in emergency room. He has presented because he is unwell and worried about his urine. He wonders if his kidney is okay. Your consultant wants you to interview him first. Please obtain a relevant history of the problem and to try to reach a diagnosis. Do your best to respond appropriately to the patient's fear and inquiries. The examiner will be monitoring you all the way around and appreciate your areas of excellence. So this is a sample of a station which we can have in the... What is the list, the most likely diagnosis of this patient? Mention three priority next step investigations. Tell us the main lines of management. And then just counsel the patient and tell him, what's your diagnosis? Does he need hospital admission or not? And your provisional prognosis for the recovery. This is as the clinical situation we can all have in the emergency room or in the department. So if I think in this patient come complaining from sudden reduction in urine volume after a 3-day history of vomiting and diarrhea. What does it mean? It is the presentation here or the complaint here is sudden reduction of urine volume. It may be oliguria or maybe retention. So I should ask the patient first about how can he diagnose this condition? What is the normal habit of you? Is this come gradually or not gradually? Is this associated with symptoms like pain? Because if the patient have retention or something like that, it will be accompanied by suprapubic pain. If it is gradual or sudden, the gradual come also with the oliguria and the anuria. And then I will ask about all other symptoms related to renal symptomatology. So if you are complaining of reduction of urine volume, are you have a fluid overload? So I will ask him about swelling of lower limbs. Do you have any symptoms related to the voiding? So I will ask him about all. So after analysis of the main complaint, which is the reduction of urine volume, I will pass to all the symptoms of the kidney and then pass to other systemic manifestations related to this complaint. What are the systemic manifestations which is related to the renal failure? We have again the kidney incriminated in multiple systemic disease. So maybe metabolic disease, are you diabetic, hypertensive or not? Some autoimmune disease, some vasculitic disorders. So I will ask about the symptoms of these diseases and disorders. If you have symptoms of pulmonary affection, cough, expectoration, hemoptysis, symptoms of GIT affection. Do you have blood stool? Do you have abdominal pain? Do you have joint affection, skin affection? All these are symptoms of other systems. I will ask about the drug history. I will ask about the most probable cause is the persistent vomiting and diarrhea. So I will ask about the analysis of vomiting and diarrhea and ask about the symptoms of hypovolemia. Do you get dizzy? Do you get do you have any low cardiac output symptoms? Because my provisional diagnosis is that's an acute reduction of the GFR due to persistent vomiting and diarrhea. Do you have an intact throat sensation? Why you didn't consume water to replace the water you lost? All these are questions I can add. Mention three priority next step investigations. So any patient with a reduction in urine, number one, I will do ultrasound to know if there is a renal problem or post-renal problem. So if there is any obstruction, full bladder, it means it is a urological problem. But if I have found a small kidney and atrophied kidney, it's a renal problem. This is number one. Number two, I will do urine analysis. If there is any sediment in the urine. Number three, I will do electrolytes to know if I have any electrolyte deficiency, any electrolyte excess. I will do APG. Those are logic and very easy. The main lines of management in this patient with reduction and hypovolemia, if I found the patient hypovolemic, I will resuscitate him with fluid and give him the priority to give fluid and follow up him if he will pass urine or not. If the patient is hypervolemic, I will give him diuretic. If the patient is obstructed, I will treat the obstruction. All these are options I can conclude to the patients. What's your diagnosis? So you will tell him, presumably you are in a reduction of your kidney function due to reduction of the perfusion of the kidney. There is some sort of dehydration. So it's expected when we correct this dehydration that the urine will come again and your problem will be solved. If you ask them about your his provisional prognosis for recovery, you will tell him that mostly or the much percent of the patients with this complaint will recover within 2 to 3 weeks. We will follow up you and we are assuring you, okay? But we don't have 100% confirmation that he will recover. This is the way we should take the history. We should think about the history, and this is the way the exam will be. It's very simple. So at the end, I'd like to thank you and just telling you that I am ready to answer any question on the email. My end advice to you, the history is not a way of just studying this lecture. You have to practice. You have to strive for continuous improvement. Learn, train, hear instructions from the doctors, practice, practice, and practice, and sure, at the end, you will reach more than you expect. Thank you and goodbye.